Hello, I'm Tara Brabazon, and welcome to the Post 35, How to Lengthen and Strengthen Your PhD. How did we get here? Because we're in the middle of our Inspirational People, Inspirational Ideas series. And yes, that's powerful and wonderful, and I'm loving doing that for you. But a couple of members of our community needed some triage support immediately, particularly before Christmas. So TACMOOC 2020, hello superstar, gave me a request, and the request read as follows, quote, "I'm at my wit's end. I'm not a wordy writer and I tend to be too concise to the detriment of my PhD thesis word count. My uni needs 80k words and I don't see this happening. Ideas for fleshing out my thesis, please." End of quote. Now, my absolute pleasure to help with this topic. I'm excited by this topic. I'm enthused by this topic. Let's go for it. And why I suppose it matters to me personally as well is I have four students submitting their PhDs before Christmas, and I've got hundreds of thousands of words and deadlines to get through. So I'm reading literally 300, 400,000 words a week. So this matters a lot to me. And it does seem important that we do a quick session today. We do a triage session for you because, and this is the important bit, the length of your PhD does matter. Now, universities have these policies about word length for a reason. And that reason is they're trying to stop you from failing. So let me explain. One of the key reasons why a student tumbles into what's often called a D or a 4, which is described as a revise and resubmit, is because of the issue of scope and scale. You're going to hear that phrase quite a lot in the post this week. Now, a proxy for scope and scale, and can I say a pretty elegant proxy for scope and scale, is word length. Now, let me rehearse the argument that's about to come back to me, right? Now, I know the usual suspects will explain to me that Stephen Hawking's thesis was 119 pages in length. And that is absolutely accurate. In fact, I'll do a link to the Hawking PhD thesis at the conclusion of this post so you can read it yourselves. Now, let's talk about this thesis. Okay, let's take this argument on. Let's talk about this thesis. Now, this thesis was in the area of theoretical physics moving into pure mathematics. Now, the first thing to consider is, do you really believe that theoretical physics to pure mathematics, that that's a generalizable thesis area for the rest of the disciplines in our university? Question mark. That's the first issue to consider. But then let's get to the real story here. This thesis was submitted for examination in 1966. I wasn't born in 1966. Most of you watching the post this week, you were not born when this thesis was examined. So yes, it was 119 pages. But hold on to yourself. It had 14 references. Yes, you heard me correctly. 14 references. So while the easy answer to anybody like me talking about the scope and scale of doctorates is what I call the Hawking defense, so they describe that this is important, great theses are short, and look, they can be, but you need to ask yourself with honesty, come on, can any topic, and I mean any topic, have and present 14 references to prove an original contribution to knowledge? Now, that was 1966. Let's think about 1966, beyond the Beatles' Revolver album, great album. But what was happening in 1966? Well, there were fewer universities, there were fewer journals, there were fewer scholars, and indeed there were fewer PhD students. And at this time, the genre or the oeuvre of a PhD was still being configured. regulation, policy and procedures were, how should we describe it, somewhat light touch, that means relatively non-existent, and the idea of international external examiners for a PhD wasn't even a consideration. So don't get me wrong, the late, great Professor Hawking, incredible scholar, brilliant man, transformative man, engaging with multiple dissemination modalities, funny as hell, great in popular culture, great human being. But let's think about what happened during his lifetime. Our universities have changed radically. Research has changed radically. And yes, standards have changed radically. And the doctoral space now is increasingly regulated. And you know I support that regulation because, and I'll give you the reason why, the PhD must mean something. It must mean something so you can take a PhD that you graduated from in one country and move countries and it still has meaning. It still confirms standards. So that means our examinations must be accountable, and they must be transparent, and the examination results must be justifiable, justifiable internationally. Now, we all know that knowledge is moving at a different pace now, and let me give you one data point to confirm that argument. The Smithsonian confirmed that 1.8 million academic articles are published every single year in 28,000 academic journals. Now, that's a very conservative figure. I found some much higher figures, to be frank with you. I went for the conservative figure that confirms the number of articles and the number of journals. Now, what's also occurring is the PhD is a genre of writing. It's not the best research you'll ever conduct. It's the worst research you'll ever conduct. But it has requirements. It has characteristics. It has standards. And one way we can help and scaffold students to produce work of that standard and demonstrate this capability and these characteristics is through word length. And trust me, of the hundreds of PhDs that I have examined around the world, the worst theses have been the short ones. Okay, and there are reasons for that. The methodology is not well presented, so it's just presented in a couple of paragraphs rather than exploring the relationship between methods and methodology. And an argument is assumed rather than made. So as an examiner, when we're reading these types of scripts, PhD scripts, we bounce around the text a lot. I'll try and explain what that means. And I've examined 22 theses this year, and about half of them have not been very good, to be frank. So a lot's going wrong here. So what's happening as I bounce around like a pinball wizard, as I bounce around these theses? Well, I continually am asking, what's going on now? Where am I? What's the point of this chapter? What's going on? So short theses worry examiners. Now, yes, you may not be compliant to regulations in your university, and that's important too. But more important, and I think where the word length becomes crucial, is what we're finding is examiners read the research and we go, look, the research is okay, but this PhD is more of the standard we would expect in honours or a capstone project or a coursework master's. That's the issue. So for TACMOOC 2020 and all our friends in the final stages of producing your thesis, hello, you are seen, we love you, we send you our support. And also for all the supervisors out there, your life is being ruined as well. Let's try and help and support you. Let's do Tara's 10 tips to lengthen and strengthen a PhD. So this is, you want to do it, this is how you do it. One, evaluate your paragraphs. Do they have a topic sentence? The quality of your paragraphs tells me about the quality of your research. Now, a student who writes short paragraphs, and I'm talking one sentence, two sentences, or three sentences. This is the characteristic of a student who has not read enough. So they have shallow knowledge and they're in the middle of a short paragraph and they can't extend that knowledge. So the problem doesn't start with the short paragraphs, but short paragraphs reveal a series of problems about a lack of reading, about problematic note-taking, and the depth of your scholarship. Now, as I was prepping for the post this week and I went back and read all that old literature on how to write a paragraph when we were kids, when we were in formal education and school, and a lot of that material is really, really easy and straightforward. And the problem is we've carried forward from primary school these assumptions about writing a paragraph, not recognizing the diversity of paragraph options that are required to write a PhD. So what is a paragraph for a PhD? Okay, well, let's start with the yeah, duh definition. And the yeah, duh definition is a paragraph is a series of sentences. Now, the word series is incredibly important there. These sentences are linked together on a particular topic, and as each sentence moves through the paragraph, it provides an arc through your argument. The first sentence is the topic sentence, and this is everything. The topic sentence explains to the reader, nay examiner, what is this paragraph doing. Then we can move to the information and the content that you need to make the case in that paragraph. Now, this is discipline dependent. It is also dependent on where you are in the thesis. So in a literature review, the paragraph and how it is constructed is different from your methodology, which is different from your conclusion, okay? You could be presenting a data point. All of these variables create different undulations in the genre of a PhD paragraph. Now, some disciplines use paragraphs, others do not, and deploy paraphrasing. So, these sentences in your paragraph present and extend a thing, a node in your argument. Then after you've used that data point, after you've used the words of others, we're about in the middle of the paragraph. Okay, so we've got a topic sentence, we've done something, we've introduced a bit of literature, we've introduced a data point, we've introduced an argument, right? So there we are. We're now halfway through your paragraph. And we start to then hit the interpretation part of your paragraph. You interpret the data set, you interpret your literature. So the previous sentences, the first half of your paragraph, the sentences were pretty neutral. Now, the second half of the paragraph, this is how I'm going to shape the argument that I'm offering to you. So I presented what I'm going to do in the topic sentence. The second half of the paragraph starts to shape and provide the texture to that argument. So if you will, the second half of the paragraph shapes what was presented in the first half, yeah? So you present your interpretation. And then, we've done really well, we're then writing the final crunchy sentence of your paragraph. So the final sentence is really tough in a paragraph because you've got to conclude the point made and provide a smooth transition to the next paragraph. Can I say the final sentence of paragraphs takes me the most time? I'm doing a final draft on an article after I finish the vlog today, and basically this draft is focusing on the last sentences of paragraphs, okay? It's the most difficult to write because it has so many purposes. There was a bug. I've just knocked a bug off the desk. Oh my goodness. Don't be frightened, Sam. Calm. Calm, see, calm, laughing. So the final sentence is the most difficult to write because it has so many purposes. It's aware of its pivotal position because it is the pivot between one paragraph and the next. But it closes one argument and it opens out another argument, okay? So I've often described When I'm teaching academic writing, I've often described a paragraph and paragraphing as a waterfall. It looks beautiful and it looks natural, but it's masking the intense work and effort that goes in to create it. Now, another metaphor that may help you is I also see paragraphs as a series of steps. So you're walking with your argument and you're taking someone with you. And each sentence is a step. So when you write great paragraphs, you are making the connections in your research. You're sewing together the building blocks of your research. Now, you're a really bright person, I know that, and you have a lot of incredibly bright ideas, and that's tremendous. But remember, a PhD is not about good ideas. It's not an original contribution to ideas. It's an original contribution to knowledge. So paragraphs allow you to take that great idea and work it into something, shape it, give it meaning, so it becomes knowledge. A paragraph moves from information and ideas to knowledge. That's what it does. So we learn to write by writing, no doubt about that, but we also learn to learn by writing. So a strong PhD is based on strong paragraphing. You check your paragraphing. Two, are at least a quarter of your references produced in the last 2 or 3 years? One reason that a thesis is short is that the research that has been undertaken is not of scope and scale. So we're going to get really honest now, okay? If you haven't got a lot of references, if you haven't got a block of research behind you, then you're not going to be able to write a lot, okay? So if you can't write a lot, that can mean you haven't read enough. Also, how can you confirm that you're making an original contribution to knowledge if you haven't referenced the research of scope and scale in your field? How can you prove it? So be honest with yourself. Come on, between us today, come on, be honest with yourself. Have you read enough? It's very easy to pretend, to tell ourselves stories that we've read enough, that we know everything on a topic, when actually we've been really, really selective in our reading and we can't write much because we don't know much. The key strategy to not only lengthen your thesis, but radically improve your thesis with regard to the capacity for it to pass, is to ensure that you have cited and interpreted everything that's been written in your topic, certainly in the last couple of years. Now, I'm recording this post nearing the end of 2022. You may be looking at it in the future, but I'm in the end of November 2022. And I'm advising all my students who are submitting shortly to have plenty of references from 2020, 2021, and 2022. Why? Think about how dated a reference looks from 2018 if an examiner is reading the thesis in 2023. Okay. But if examiners see research that's cited from the 2020s, we relax. We go, oh, right, this person's done some hard yakka, done some hard work, and it's much easier to make the case for originality when we're seeing references from the last couple of years. So if you are lacking length, go into Google Scholar today, girlfriend, today. Put in an important search term from your research field, limit the material to stuff published after 2020, and your brain will probably explode. So read that work and insert it throughout your entire thesis, making sure there's lots of early references in your introduction and you're bringing it home in your conclusion. Now, three, check that you have been completist when referencing your key researchers. Oh yeah. Do you have all the references from your key researchers on your topic? Or have you been patchy? in every research field, make sure that you know the 10 big names, the 10 big researchers in your field. For those of you that have done my PhD setup document, you know in the first meeting, I say to students, write down the 10 main researchers in your field. And I do that so when they're about to finish, we can return to that list. Now, that list is not only important, I need you to be completest with the researchers on that list. Now, I recently examined a very poor thesis on a topic, and two references were cited from an absolutely key researcher from 2006. Now, the candidate didn't realize that that researcher had written on her exact topic in 2015. She hadn't read it. She didn't know about it. So she's making all these statements about this is the first piece, this is my original contribution to knowledge. And a guy had already done the project in 2015. She hadn't read enough to know that. So all her discussions about original contributions to knowledge were destroyed because a scholar that she actually cited talked about her thesis in 2015. So if you are worried about the length of your thesis, return to your key researchers. Put their names into Google Scholar today and check that you have all their research discussed in your thesis. For the important scholars, don't be patchy. Be completest. 4. Oh yeah, present a strong section on ethics in your methodology chapter. Now, as the recent controversy in the journal Qualitative Research confirms, even unobtrusive research methods require a pretty robust discussion of ethics. For every thesis, go into your methodology section with a deep and powerful part on ethics. And you need to disclose clearly and overtly the ethical decisions that you have made. Why have you selected this topic? Did COVID, did any other variables have an impact on that selection? Are you using reactive or non-reactive methods? Why? Is the topic controversial for some groups? Why? And then talk through that controversy. Present those ethical dilemmas and how you handled them. So every single topic has an ethical lens to explore and to present. At its most basic, so if you just go, well, where do I start? At its most basic, ethics commences with risks. The risks present in your research to yourself and to other humans, objects, the environment. Think about the risks, though, of not doing the research. That's just as important. What are the risks of not doing the research to yourself, to others, to the environment? So besides risk, the other word to ponder is harm. Harm. Who is harmed by your research? Who is harmed by not doing your research? So as you can see, ethics actually matters to every single research project. It's not simply a matter, bizarrely, of an ethics clearance from a higher education institution. That's important, and that needs to be discussed in a robust and clear fashion. Now, for some topics, often in the social sciences, allied health professions, absolutely crucial. But for all topics, every topic, we make ethical decisions. We decide on one method and not another, and they are assessments about risk and harm. And I want to hear about those. As always, if you'd like to see some really innovative research on risk and harm, if you'd like to help yourself to do this work quickly, then I draw you to the ultra realist criminologists, okay? Steve Hall, Simon Winlow, Thomas Raymond, Oliver Smith. And as you know, and a lot of you have subscribed to it, which is terrific, but as you know, they've got a fantastic video series now on YouTube, freely available. So if you want some work on harm and risk, then you can just simply load up these videos, go for a walk, listen to it at the gym, listen to it on the commute. Okay, so this is great stuff, really important stuff, and modern and current. So in your thesis, examiners note, we understand the incredible polarity in higher education at the moment and life, and we'll appreciate you taking on the intricate and complicated discussions about ethics that go even beyond institutional ethical clearances. I'm not minimising those, they're absolutely crucial, but ethics is even more than those sort of ethics committees. Five. If you want to pass, this is how you pass. Five. In paragraph 3 of every chapter, write a structuring paragraph for the examiner. So third paragraph in every chapter, let me tell you what you do. Now, as you know, I read a lot of student work, hundreds of thousands of words of student work a week. And I read a lot of my own work every week. And I find myself thinking a lot, what's actually going on here? Where am I? What is going on? And this is particularly true in large pieces of work. So yes, theses, also scholarly monographs, books. And I often ask myself, where am I in this argument? Where exactly am I? And you see, the best of writers are also tour guides. They guide their reader, nay, examiner, through the prose. So think about it when you are visiting a new place, right? You get in the car, you get in a train, and you go and visit a place you haven't visited before. You get out of the car, get out of the train, and you walk up and down the street. You go, oh, that's interesting. Wow, that's interesting. Yeah, good, interesting. Now, everything sort of looks new and interesting, but you've got no idea what it is. You've got no idea of the context to actually explain what you're seeing. So if you go on a tour guide allows you to understand what you're looking at, its history, its significance. And you see, the best writers do the same. Now, I recommend that every single PhD student, in every single chapter that you write, that you take one paragraph, often the third paragraph, and you explain, here we go, where are we in this thesis? So what's just happened? What did the previous chapter do? What are we doing here? Where are we going in the next chapter? And how does this chapter contribute to my significant original contribution to knowledge? Now, I call this the structuring paragraph for a doctorate, but for an examiner, these paragraphs are also the touchstone points for us, where you demonstrate that you are building an original contribution to knowledge in each chapter and you're aware of it. So remember my maxim, make the case. Don't assume the case, make the case. So what you're doing is you're guiding your examiner through your thesis, like a tour guide through a museum. Excuse me. So what you're doing is you're explaining where we are, where we've been, where we're going, and why it matters. So those paragraphs in each of your chapters are some of the most important paragraphs that you will write in this thesis. Okay, six. Poor PhDs have short introductions. I often talk about deal breakers in doctoral education, and one of the key deal breakers is a short introduction. If you're worried about the length of your PhD, the first stop to solve that problem is have a good concrete look at your introduction. And if it's a short introduction, you are in trouble. Full stop. A short introduction demonstrates that a doctoral candidate has no real sense of their thesis, its developmental arc, or academic protocols. The introduction to a PhD has clear functions. Remember, we talk about the genre of a PhD. Well, that genre starts in the introduction. So let's do this. What does an introduction do? It must set the scene for your research. It must present the disciplinary literacies and the intellectual landscape of your thesis. And, oh boy, yeah, if you're saying that your thesis is interdisciplinary or transdisciplinary or multidisciplinary or postdisciplinary, that's great. That's not a throwaway word. That is the start of a conversation. If you've written an interdisciplinary thesis, you need to explain what you mean by interdisciplinary, what particular theorists you've used to guide that particular combination, and why interdisciplinarity matters to this PhD, why it was the way to do the thesis, not an alternative. Okay, so an introduction has to provide the key information that you believe the examiner needs to enter your intellectual world. So yes, it presents the research questions, it can present a thesis statement, depending on your discipline, and it must present the SOC, the Significant Original Contribution to Knowledge. So it presents the chapters and, yes, the summary of their contents, but it also presents your ontology, methodology, and epistemology and the relationship between them. So it's providing the context for your research project. So as you can see, the introduction also presents to your examiner what you are discussing, what you are not discussing, what you are presenting and how you are presenting this content, and why this thesis emerged at this particular point and why you are the person to write this thesis. So if it helps you, the introduction provides the key information that you believe the examiner needs to enter your world. Now, if the introduction is short or it's insipid, then it's a characteristic of much wider problems in the thesis. And to be frank, there's frequently absolutely no way out of a weak introduction. So if you're worried about the length of your thesis, the first concern, the main concern you need to address is the length of your introduction. Check it and check that all the variables I've just talked about in the last 2 minutes are present in that introduction, and that'll get you to word length. 7, long conclusions are crucial. Okay, conclusions are crucial in a different way from an introduction because they are the final attempt for you to show to an examiner that your thesis is worthy. We are not worthy, be worthy, write it in the conclusion. So this is crucial. Wow, the conclusion must answer why. Why? Weak theses focus on the what and the how. The what and the how, they're easy questions. The thesis, the PhD thesis questions, are why. Your conclusion does why. A short conclusion is really serious, but it has different causes to the short introduction that I just discussed. Now, to give you an example, a thesis that I was reading, it was magnificent, it was wonderful, it was heading for a 1, an A, straight through, no corrections, fantastic, wonderful thesis. And then I got to the conclusion, and it was a 2-page conclusion. And the thesis tumbled from a 1, straight through, to a 3, major corrections. And of course, the major correction was, girlfriend, write a conclusion. So they wrote the thesis very well, but they just did not have that final burst of energy to write a conclusion of depth and of innovation. And remember, the conclusion has got to have energy. Come on, it's got to have energy. Explain to the examiners why they should care. Come on. They've just given you 4 days of their lives. Explain to the examiners why those 4 days really mattered, why you matter, why this research matters. Answer that question. Why does this research matter? Do it in the conclusion. Now, short and mediocre conclusions in PhDs are very common, and this means when the examiners come to read the PhD, it's short, it's ill-focused, it wanders around a bit. So a lot of conclusions don't provide any value add to the thesis at all. Now, great conclusions are amazing. They do differ by disciplines, okay? The sciences do have shorter conclusions, the humanities do have longer conclusions, and the social sciences, like Goldilocks's chair, is beautiful and perfect in the middle. So can I quantify that length? You know what? Yeah, I reckon I can. Now remember, doctoral examination is a dark art. Right, and by that I mean you're always going to get some random that is inventing, you know, dropped a tab of acid in 1974 and decides this is a particular thing that's incredibly important for them, okay? Every now and again you'll get a random that does that. As the regulations of doctorates increase, that sort of behaviour is reducing, okay? But, you know, occasionally you get an examiner that's got this whole notion of standards in their head that no one else agrees with, okay? But basically, get the conclusion to 5,000 words minimum. 5,000 words minimum. Now, for my science crew out there, hello, you've just had a heart attack. Let me explain to you how I can get you to 5,000 words, okay? And I'll give you the scaffolding, the headings to use to get you to 5,000. Now, for the social sciences, there's some added words that come along, often that leads into recommendations, right? Recommendations and further work, often quite important for the social sciences and for the humanities. Mm-hmm. This is your time to shine. Your conclusion is sexy. Your conclusion is big. You are selling your work. You are selling your scholarship. Show your significance. So I'll talk about how to sell that well. Right. So therefore, in the conclusion, you need to get the mindset right for the conclusion, right? You need to be confident, right? You're coming into the conclusion. This thesis is fantastic. I am fabulous, and I am going to write a fantastic conclusion because I'm fabulous, right? And you need to get into the, yeah, come on, energy when you're doing the conclusion, okay? So remember, you're frocking this thing up. You're making your thesis look the best it can be. You're not over-egging the omelette, you're not inventing stuff, but you're making it look good, okay? You're not sort of presenting a potato sack with a belt, okay? Don't clothe your thesis like a potato sack. You want it to be frocked up. You want it to be fabulous. Sell me the research, okay? You have a lot to say, and the conclusion is where you confirm that this thesis matters. Now remember, crucial things about the conclusion. It does not present new data, okay? No new data sets. But what is new in the conclusion is you are reflecting on the research. The conclusion is the space of reflection. It creates the synthesis. It builds the component parts into something important. It finishes off the work. It provides a satisfying end to the research. It's like the hem of a frock. You don't want sort of the jagged edge. You could have beautiful material, but the edge is a bit jagged and it's fraying. Well, what's going on here? So the conclusion hems the frock nicely, creates a smooth, even ending. The conclusion needs to confirm to the examiner that you have delivered on your significant original contribution to knowledge, and you need to use that language. Remember, the examiner has just waded through 80,000 words, perhaps with a glass of Chianti, and they need to be reminded why your research matters. So have at least, for me, at least one paragraph in your conclusion that begins with, the topic sentence is, my original contribution to knowledge is, boom. Sell the thesis, sell that originality. The examiner must not be in any doubt that this is a PhD, it's not a master's. That's what I've seen increasingly in what I've been examining in the last 2-3 years. It's been a stunning turn of events, really, where the originality's not been put in place. It's really a synthesis thesis. So remember, this is about originality, not synthesizing what existed in the past. Remember that a conclusion is more than a summary. A summary is certainly part of the conclusion, absolutely, particularly through the empirical social sciences and the sciences. You must summarise your findings. What happened? Where are we? What's the output? But the conclusion has to be more than that. So yes, write the summary of your research. What happened? What happened in this thesis? What happened? But remember this point. You're synthesizing this thesis, showing the whole that you have created. So part of what is the more than that, so what's more than a summary that we're putting in here, is how your research has contributed to the discipline. Please do that well. All the theses I've been reading recently have not done this well. How has this research contributed to your discipline? If you're doing interdisciplinary work, make the case that the interdisciplinarity mattered. Don't assume it. Don't throw the word interdisciplinarity in. Talk about it. Make it meaningful. Take it for a walk. What have you added to knowledge? Okay. It might be, for example, something as simple as you're enhancing methods. You've trialed a new method and it sort of worked, had some flaws, but you tried something new. That's great. You might have been working with new literature, more popular cultural literature. You may have found a new grey literature source. That's original. That's great. Building interdisciplinary links. Tremendous work, okay? So LinkedIn is what went wrong. Oh, always do this. What went wrong? Talk about it. Wring your hands. Oh, this was a problem. We love that stuff. Okay, so tell us about the problems, right? Then also the future work, the trajectories out of the thesis. So as you can see in the social sciences and the health sciences in particular, this future work is often linked with recommendations, okay? So we see it a lot in social work, allied health, some of the professions. So what you're doing is saying, here is my research, and this is what I recommend from my research to improve professional practice. Oh, they're great parts of theses. Write that for me. Sometimes this characteristic of the thesis is referred to as extendability. Okay, some people love extendability, and there is an argument that the best theses have extendability. Not sure about that, depends on the discipline. But what is the impact of your research? How is this research, how could this research provide an intervention into society? So yes, there is an original contribution to knowledge, but if the impact is political, or social, or theoretical, I could go on, then specify that in the conclusion. Be clear about what your research shows, what does your research do, what does your research not do, what doesn't it do, and what are the implications of what it does and what it doesn't do. Yeah. So this is your last opportunity to calm the examiner. Make us feel relaxed. We're very comfortable to pass you. Use the space available to you. Use this thesis length to relax us as examiners. 8, put your socks everywhere. What makes a PhD a PhD and not a research master's is a significant original contribution to knowledge. Every part of your thesis must mention the sock. I want to see the sock in the abstract. I want to see the sock in the introduction. I want to see the sock every single chapter. I want to see the sock in the conclusion, okay? If an examiner, this happens a lot, if an examiner is trying to find your sock, it's, can I say, as an examiner, this is frightening, okay? So I'm reading it, I'm going, where's the sock? Haven't found the sock? Where's, and I'm trying to find the sock for you, right? And I can't find the sock. It gets frightening. Now, therefore, don't frighten your examiner. Tell us the sock, and then we calm down, we're having a lovely time. You cannot be too obvious. Okay? Don't think you're being repetitive. You're not. Share the sock with us. Show us in each chapter, the best theses do this, show us in each chapter how this chapter is adding the next layer to your significant original contribution to knowledge. Therefore, ask yourself in each chapter, have I talked about the sock today? Okay? Without a sock, it's not a thesis. Prove that you have a sock by writing it into the thesis. 9. Talk about what went wrong methodologically. Now, it may seem antithetical to your thesis, right, that you admit weakness, you admit when stuff went wrong. Actually, it's the complete opposite. examiners love, we so love hearing about your problems. We love hearing about what went wrong, you know. And the reason we love hearing about the errors is not that we're sort of tortured, well, we might be, but we love hearing about the errors because that shows that you, as a researcher, you're reflexive about your process and your praxis. If everything went well, that's all great, we start to get a bit worried because stuff always goes wrong in research. So tell us about the stuff that went wrong and what you would do differently. That shows you are a reflexive researcher. Tick. So in your methodology section, be honest. What went wrong? What could you have done differently? What could you improve? Don't hesitate. Present the challenges. If you've got a COVID story, oh, I love me a COVID story. If you've got a COVID story about methodology, you ring that one out, mate. Come on, tell us the COVID story. We love that stuff. So don't gloss over the problems. Put the problem into the work. 10, we got here. Ponder the use of a prologue to present your positionality. Here we go, prologue. Couple of thousand words at the front of the thesis. Now we've talked a lot in this current series, The Post, but also in the last vlog series about positionality, about reflexive research. We've also talked about storying and storytelling about a month ago. So let's start to gather these ideas together. Ponder whatever discipline you're in, and I've seen this work in experimental science, I've seen it work in social work, I've seen it work in economics, I've seen it work in history. Pick a discipline, I've seen this work. Ponder writing a prologue. Who are you? Why do you matter to this research? What is the lens that you bring to this research? And what brought you to this topic? Now, this section, this prologue of your research can have a very strong theoretical grounding. Positionality at its best asks all of us, whatever our discipline, to take a breath and think about our relationship to the research, our relationship with research objects, our relationship with research subjects. Now, while the most advanced and gritty version of positionality probably came from feminists in the 1970s, wow, there's some pretty gritty stuff there, can I say? Outside of feminism, there are still powerful positionality conversations to be had about the power that we as researchers hold and the consequences of the power that we hold on the people around us and the topics that we study. And further, this isn't just thinking about power and intentions, but how who we are transforms and builds our research design, our research questions, our methodology, epistemology, ontology, and also how we think about research dissemination. Positionality is now reaching a really strong level of complexity in the literature. And I log Danielle Jacobson and Nida Mustafa's remarkable social identity map. See if this helps you structure a prologue. Their map has three tiers. Firstly, the identification of social identities. Secondly, how these positionalities impact on life. And finally, how particular details in society are tied up with that social identity. So the goal through moving through those tiers is explicitness, okay? As they state, quote, being explicit about our social identities allows us as researchers to produce reflexive research and give our readers the tools to recognize how we produced the data. End of quote. I also want to log Anissa Jafar's intervention in the very foundation of these debates about positionality, where she explores how positionality operates in quantitative studies. She argues, and this is blows your head off stuff, right? She argues that without a discussion of positionality, quantitative research is not managing bias and therefore is undermining any claim for validity. With all the attention on measuring and testing and proving, the issue is how positionality, how bias creates a distortion in data sets. Well, she showed particularly in the medical sciences how objects that seemingly appear to have an objective meaning change as they move through different contexts. Wow. And she is certainly aware of the scale of her revisionism. She states that positionality, quote, challenges the quantitative approach to validity and suggests that in order to know what is really being measured, it is essential to know more details about who is doing the measuring. End of quote. Where I'm profoundly convinced by her argument is her comment that, and think about it this way, when discussions of positionality don't reach the page, the audience, the readers, the examiners are not given the opportunity to assess how those social variables had consequences on research validity or outcomes. Now, that is incredibly important to all research. Imagine you as a writer not giving examiners the opportunity to reflect on the validity of your outputs. So when you're thinking about lengthening your thesis, when you're thinking about strengthening your thesis, realize that demonstrating your positionality, demonstrating your lens on research, shows how your methods have been constructed and impacted, how your observations were configured, how your interpretations were configured, and how your analysis was constructed. That's probably the most important writing that we'll ever do. Presenting your positionality in a prologue means that all of us come to research acknowledging overtly who we are and how that has impacted on what we study. So TACMOOC 2020, we did it. I hope this has been useful to you. 10 strategies today to both lengthen and strengthen your PhD. Now, every success to you, and please let us know how you go. Let us know what happens. And I wish you all, including the cockroach, I wish you all love, light, and peace. Tea out.